Everybody, welcome. It's great to have you here. As expected, we've got a great turnout, and that's no surprise because we've got, in fact, not just Geoffrey Bowker from UC Irvine, but he's accompanied by Judith Gregory, who will also be speaking today. First of all, Geoff is here not because Kit has flown him out from UC Irvine here. He's here because thanks to Maureen Henninger and colleagues in FAS, he was keynoting at the Document Academy conference last week. Brilliant presentation there. And I think there's more of the song to come this afternoon. Geoff and I have known each other probably since the late 90s when I was a research fellow at the Open University trying to get my head around knowledge management, which was all the craze at that point. And I was pinging Geoff emails because I'd been so inspired by his writing and his great book, Sorting Things Out, Classification and Its Consequences, was in press at the time. And I was desperate to get page numbers from him and so forth because I was quoting him in this material I was writing for MBA students who were trying to get their heads around knowledge management. What's the role of technology and all of that? And Geoff has been very gracious. Collaborator and inviting me to some of his workshops over the years, so it's great to catch him as he comes through Australia. Geoff is professor at the School of Information and Computer Science at UC Irvine, and he is one of the world's leading thinkers on how our values and worldviews sort of start to get baked into the classification schemes we invent, especially in science, but in many other aspects of society, and then that starts to sink into our information infrastructure and becomes invisible, but is invisibly shaping and constraining the way that we count things. And counting things is terribly important, as we all know. Geoff will be speaking for a while, and then we're going to have some Q&A. And then he's going to hand over to Judith Gregory. And Judith is the co-director at UC Irvine of the Evoke and Values in Design Lab. So Values in Design is certainly one strand which joins them together. And Judith is particularly interested in personal health informatics, the whole quantified self movement. That will ring some bells for you here. So she's going to share briefly some thoughts about what she's been doing, again, to provoke some comment and discussion. Okay. So without further ado, great pleasure to have you here, Geoff and Judith, and we'll hand over to you for Big Data Vibrations. Welcome, Geoff.
All right, thanks so much for the generous introduction, Simon. It's just a real pleasure to be here. I mean, I feel like this is like, I saw a film once of Héloïse and Abelard, and the old Sorbonne. You used to kind of have the lecturer in the center of the room, and you know, the kind of students in the, and the audience and the gods around them. And so one walked around and were peppered with questions from every angle. So I'm way looking forward to this. I will start with a thank you. Which is to DOCAM, Documents Academy, and Maureen, and to Charles Sturt University, and to UTS, who brought me out here to Australia. Largely grew up in Australia, delight as ever to be back. Vibrations, I'll get to the theme vibrations in a minute throughout the talk, but I'm happy to talk about it more as we get into Q&A afterwards. I'm drawing here on the work of Dominique Boulier, who says we're dealing with a fundamental new social fact with big data. It ain't just about more crunching or the way in which society works today. It's fundamentally new ways of thinking and organizing our social lives and our intellectual lives. So I was actually born at the dawning of the age of Aquarius, but you know, I'm now living in the dawn of big data, and that's what I really want to chat with you about today, talk with you about today in many ways. I mean, big data, we all know the statistics. It's what's happening in business. It's what's happening in science. It's the huge growth industry that we should all be paying attention to. I mean, you can see the graphic better than I can, so I'm not going to read much of it off. But the potential growth in big data right now is huge. I'm going to be spending some time today on another theme. This is the quantified self. Actually, Judith is going to be talking more about the quantified self. It's about the degree to which it's changing what it means to be human and what it is to be social. This graphic I particularly love. It's a graphic of where people would be happy to have data about themselves represented, being gathered on different parts of their bodies. I can't read the data. An amount of it is, whether you want it tattooed in your skin, whether you want it a microchip implanted, whether you want a device like a watch or a Fitbit. It really does change what it means to be human, to move into this new kind of measurement regime. And I really do want to be talking about that some today. So we're going to be looking at big data in general. And just to end the introduction, let's end the introduction on a tangent. There is a wonderful new article in Science a few weeks ago about, well, we've got all these people who are producing fake scientific papers and getting them published. They've had to retract, I think, over 150 papers recently in major scientific journals. And so what they now have is hoax detecting software, which spots fake papers. So it's kind of a battle. Who is doing the reading in this process? Who is paying attention to the interpretive work that's going on? If the reading is being done by, if the writing is being done by computer and the reading is being done by computer, how do we cope with that as a social phenomenon, as an intellectual phenomenon? And I actually want to talk a lot today about how we really bring human readership, human analysis and critical thinking into the worlds of big data. Actually, one more thing to finish the intro. We often think of big data and the world, just like the world of the internet, as being all these clean, pipes and machines that go bing in the night. The reality of big data and the reality of the internet, it's a way messy phenomenon. And I'm going to be talking quite a lot about the messiness of it. So I'm not going to. What I'm going to do is run through a series of themes that I think are really important about ethical and social values in the development and practice of big data. So prediction and control is the first. Feedback loops, and I go right back here to James Beninger and his wonderful book, The Control Revolution. What he talks about was the late 19th century was really the period of the control revolution. This is where we had, cybernetics, the principle of cybernetics is the governor. The governor is that machine, which is the homeostatic machine, which is used as the machine gets hotter and hotter, arms go up, restrict the flow of oxygen to the machine so it gets cooler, and then it goes down, then it goes back up. So it's a homeostatic machine, but it's working on the basis of feedback loops. And Beninger's argument is in the late 19th century, we really started to conceive of society and our social work in terms of feedback loops and how we manage the feedback loops. And coincidentally, Beninger is really clear on that's the origin of mass advertising. And that's the origin of brand advertising. So it's no mistake that we see, Google, Amazon, all these good companies, so on and so forth, are based on advertising. It's the feedback loop that's being set up between the nature of citizenship and the smooth working of society. So the dream of the feedback loop has been with us, as I say, since the late 19th century. It really came to an apogee in the 1950s, 60s with first order cybernetics. And I will, if we want to talk about it later, go into first and second order cybernetics. This was Chile before Allende's Chile, the control room for the Chilean economy before the CIA decided to destroy the copper industry in Chile and overthrow Allende. But the idea was we gather together data about the economy, about all aspects of the economy, into a feedback loop that allows us the best possible control over the future. Now, one of the things that big data can do in this feedback loop is prediction. And I'm going to be slightly contrarian right now and just speak against prediction for a few minutes. This is... The picture here is Brian Harcourt's book entitled Against Prediction, which is about use of prediction by the police force. So let's talk about a project that's going on in the States right now, PredPol, Predict Crime in Real Time. Predictive policing is actually really interesting. It's been taken up by the cities, city of LA, city of Santa Cruz in California. What predictive policing does is it says, given that a crime has occurred in a certain area, we can use that to predict where future crimes will occur. The algorithm they actually use, and this is one of the absolutely wonderful and interesting things about big data, the algorithm is an earthquake prediction algorithm. So it's given that you have an earthquake in an area, you know there are going to be aftershocks. So how do you predict the aftershocks? So they're using this for predictive policing. So let's look at the next slide before I rabbit on too much. Yeah, let's stay on that. A couple of interesting things about predictive policing. The way in which they use it in Santa Cruz in LA, if you've predicted that there will be a crime in a certain area, you send out squad cars to that area who sit in the space and you patrol the area more intently with an idea of stopping the crime before it occurs. There are many problems with this on a social values basis. One is, how do you check? How do you know that you've stopped a crime that was going to occur? It's exactly the same as if no crime had occurred. What happens to a community, and Simon and Teresa and I were talking about this a little bit before, what happens to a community where police cars start churning up, you know, all hours of day and night to prevent a crime that didn't happen? I mean, it's a kind of... it can create real problems and, you know, it can create a bad image of that community and what it means to live in that community, which is possibly completely unfair. And even if predictive policing worked, we've got no way of knowing. I mean, maybe it was just a one-off crime, but it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. And so the cities and the states that are building up these predictive policing models have no way of testing them, no theoretical way of testing them against any... there are theoretical ways of testing them against external realities, but they're not doing it. Prediction, let's give another example, which many of you will know and some of you will not. that is a pregnant woman with a target on her belly. This is the famous Target case, where the Target store in America, Target chain in America, predicted that a teenage kid was going to have a child, not based on her buying diapers, but based on that her changed pattern of purchases in, I think, you know, the first and second trimesters of her pregnancy. They then sent her, sent her all this beautiful documentation at home about, oh, the wonders of, what you need for your childbirth. And her parents were totally pissed when they found out about it because she hadn't told the parents she was pregnant. So it's like Target got to find out before her parents. Janet Vertese, who's a fantastic researcher at Princeton University in the field of big data. Janet actually was recently pregnant. I'm glad to say she had a very nice child as a result. She tried to opt out of big data and opt out of any possible collection of the fact that she was pregnant online. And the takeaway was she looked like a criminal when she was doing it. She used Bitcoin. She used cash transactions. She never shopped in the same store twice. She was moving all over the city. So exactly the same thing that criminals do was what Janet had to do in order to live in a world where it couldn't be predicted that she was pregnant. And that prediction is enormously powerful. Here's one, Peter Scott, who's, I think you're very lucky to have him at UTS, is going to be coming to UTS, as I understand from Simon in the next couple of months. This was a dystopian story from the Financial Times last week. A week after students begin their distant learning courses at the UK's Open University this October, a computer program will have predicted their final grade. So, you know, don't even bother going. An algorithm monitoring how much the new recruits have read of their online textbooks and how keenly they have engaged with learning forums will cross-reference this information against data on each person's socioeconomic background. It will identify those likely to founder and pinpoint where they will start struggling. And by the way, those of you who are the Kindle users, I am so annoyed at Kindle. They're collecting all this information on your reading habits and what you underline. So sometimes they represent that as you're reading a Kindle book. But they're keeping it as proprietary data. It's not open source. And I think it's reading habits are providing them with incredibly valuable data, which they're not giving back to us on a regular basis. Now, in many ways, Open University, and I'm going to come back to another example of this a little bit later in the talk, the OU is doing this in precisely the right way. They've developed a policy on the ethical use of student data for learning analytics. They've really recognized right from the get-go that if you're dealing with big data, you've absolutely got to be thinking about the values and ethics that you're playing with at the same time. I've only had a chance to glance through this policy, but from what I've seen of it, I think it's actually a very rich one and a very good basis for future thinking about these styles of issues. Prediction as well in new medical tests. Predictive algorithms are in themselves really interesting. And the question we have to ask there in values terms are, well, yeah, it's nice to know that I have a 68% chance of getting Alzheimer's in 10 years, which I probably do. Certainly the way I'm feeling right now. Is it nice to know it? Well, is it nice for me to know it if there's nothing I can do about it? I mean, that's the obvious one. I mean, it's like the prediction does me no good whatsoever. It serves other people's functions, but not mine. But the other one is, what are the limits of prediction? And it's all the case with values and big data. It's all the case of the level of granularity which you're willing to go down to. If they predict when I'm 5 years old that I'm likely to be antisocial, and I was by most definitions antisocial, well, most of my large portion of my life, but, before I discovered before I discovered niceness. If they can predict, right from the outset or from early on that I'm likely to be an antisocial personality and then nip it in the bud before it happens, that's a really strange form of control that's going on. And it's all based on, lots of this stuff, it's like America, you got the same thing in the States with, psychiatric medicine. They want you to be completely normal all the time. They want you to be flat on the curve. So it's never going to be a case of let's look for and allow for the cycles. That's what we should be arguing for in policy terms. People go in and out. People go crazy for a few years. That's just great. They're sometimes, they come back much better. They come back more creative. They get great ideas, and then they settle into the rhythm. But they want to flatline you. It's exactly the homeostasis of the control revolution. They want to keep everything totally flat. But then, even worse, what if genetically in the womb they can work out this is likely to be an antisocial or a bad personality? Well, let's stop them from being born. It's closing that prediction cycle. And where and when and how you close that prediction cycle, which is really interesting. Simon and I were just talking a little bit before, and he said, well, that's certainly one of the issues with the use of prediction in the educational model, that they predict that you're going to be a problem student coming in. And so they give you attention coming in. But the very fact that they're giving you attention, well, it's schizophrenic. One side of it is the Hawthorne effect. Anybody who's given attention is going to do better, whatever the attention is. It's a very well-known finding. But the inverse side is you've been stigmatized as a possible problem from the day in which, or your very early days in your university career, and there's got to be something problematic about that. So control and control loops. How am I off the time? All right, I'm going to go relatively quickly through this. What I love in this, and this is about control and big data, stay happy, choose technology, the one wearable that will change your life. So the main problem that we have, in today's society, we're supposed to be always on, always active, always working at peak efficiency. Muse will sort of people spend 47% of their days not really concentrating, not really thinking, not really being productive. So this will model you in real time. Again, the feedback loop. Work out when your attention is drifting and bring you back into a state of full attention so you can be maximally productive. And so this is the one wearable technology you'll need. Dick Boland has a fantastic article about the executive jacket, which works off this principle. Control. Where is the site of social control in big data, and how do we ourselves get in touch with it? Tarleton Gillespie has done some great work about Twitter and Twitter trending. And it is amazing that Twitter trends do not represent things like Occupy Wall Street. They do not represent certain movements which trend very greatly within the Twitterverse, but they would much prefer to have Taylor Swift, or some pop figure in their trending. We don't get to control those algorithms, even though those algorithms are pretty central to how we think and act and experience the world around us. They're proprietary algorithms, just like the Google algorithm. We can't control that. We have no external oversight over it, despite the importance of it. And I think that's something we absolutely need to work out modes of dealing with. And the dangers of social control, I'll just rip through, but you all know the Facebook experiment, A-B testing, where what Facebook did was provide negative news feeds to one group of people, positive news feeds to another group of people, and see how their emotions changed as a result, the emotional terms they were using. Extremely successful in terms of what's called emotional contagion. The way in which they've kind of gotten around it right now, the top left, they're going to turn their A-B testing open source. Bottom right, they wrote an article for Science, which is the main, one of the main science journals, to try and justify their findings. What's really interesting about this, certainly in the States, I don't know what's going on in Australia, is that so much basic research in social science is being offloaded from the universities onto companies like Facebook, like Twitter, like Google, over which we have no oversight. Oh, that's really bad English. Sorry about that. Okay, I am going far too slowly, so I'm going to speed up. So privacy, visibility. That's one of the things about big data. We assume that we're going to be visible all the time. You already have zero privacy. Get over it, says Scott McNeely of Sun Microsystems. I mean, you've all seen these stories. It's largely something I believe. You really, really have zero privacy. Get over it. There is no such thing as privacy on the internet. Those of you that watch Person of Interest, my favorite TV show, will be aware of it. It's a cultural phenomenon. That obviously goes back to the early period of governmentality, as described by Michel Foucault. This is a panopticon, where what you're doing is you can see the invisible surveillors in the center can see absolutely into the cell of everyone they are surveilling. Bruno Latour has a wonderful phrase for that in Paris, the Invisible City, where he talks about it's not the panopticon. They really, really don't want to be seeing everything. It's the oligopticon. Oligo means small. They want to see as much as they need to in order to control. But I think the oligopticon that we're creating right now, I mean, it's complete freedom within the bounds of control. That's certainly the move that we're getting into. This idea of the lived visible life, Leigh Star, who I partly dedicate this talk to, and we, by the way, we have a plug. We have a book coming out of and about her work, MIT Press, in October. I was very interested in the Dionne quintuplets. Dionne quintuplets, born in the 1930s, I think, in Canada. They were surveilled. Every aspect of their surveilled. Every aspect of their life was surveilled from the day they were born. The toys they played with, how much they shat, how much they pissed, what they ate, when they ate it, how they played. It's an absolutely incredible record. They also became these cultural icons. So you could buy cereal, Dion quintuplet cereal, Dion quintuplet this and that and the other. Palm olive soap. As they moved into this kind of surveillance regime, which is one which we're moving into more and more nowadays, you can see the advantage of it. I mean, it's the scientists who are looking at and creating this really interesting data set, and obviously having quintuplets to play with is a whole lot of fun. But thinking about what are the values that we're really playing with as we move into the surveillance are interesting. I've been working with a company in Silicon Valley called Planet Labs. What Planet Labs are doing, they put a flock, as they call it, it's a flock of satellites, an exaltation of larks, a flock of satellites. They put a flock of satellites into space, so it's about 100, 120 satellites, which are taking high-resolution images of each part of the Earth's surface every day. And they've been trying to work with us about, well, what are the ethical values that they need to build into this absolutely glorious device. I mean, it's fantastic that we have this kind of data available to us. But how do they deal ethically with the questions that arise? They're a particularly interesting group. They come out of Pugwash, which is a union of concerned scientists in Britain, which has been wondering for years, since the 1950s anti-nuclear armament, about the role, about the moral role of science. Now, there's some stuff about this which, you know, is highly unproblematic. This is the Burdekin River, I hope I'm pronouncing that right, in Queensland last month. Isn't it wonderful to be able to see that? You can watch the way in which the stream changes over time. What you're seeing there is the mud plains around the Burdekin River. Here's forestry in Canada, in Quebec, in Canada. We very rarely understand how forestry works, partly because of an absolutely wonderful concept, the viewshed, which is in Canada and throughout the world, when they want to do really bad forestry, which this is an example of. The reason they've got those little copses is because those little trees in the middle of the clear cutting, is that clear cutting is recognized as illegal and bad, but if you leave one or two trees standing, it's no longer clear cutting, so they're able to do it. The best way to do forestation is actually by evenly taking out trees from across the forest. But this is the way which is financially easiest. So you can pick up on stuff like deforestation. You can pick up on the effects of climate change. Let's go back to Burdekin though. You can zero in on the houses at the bottom of that picture, and this is one of the examples they came up to me with. Everyone loves paedophiles when it comes to big data. Is you could check if someone's got a large garden, a paedophile could look in and see that there are toys in the yard, there are swings in the yard, which indicates there is a young child living there, and use that to target their next victim. Now, I don't have time. There's a whole thin end of the wedge argument here, which I may come back to in a second. But anyway, so they're trying to deal with, they want to release this data after 3 months, make it open source. But how do they make it open source? Who do they work with? These are completely non-obvious questions. They agree they will not share the data with the CIA, because the CIA will use it for problematic reasons, and they're an independent company, which is absolutely marvelous. And the CIA is really after them. They really, really want their data. They will sell it to the Department of Defense, because the Department of Defense frequently does humanitarian work, which is really interesting. So they've directed the Department of Defense use it for humanitarian purposes. They will not sell it to Apple, because Apple absolutely wants exclusive use of the data, and they want to render it open source after 3 months. So visibility, I don't have time to do this, just very quickly. Deep Dive is a really interesting program developed in Stanford, California. Deep Dive is trying to look at the deep web, dark web, turn the dark web into a series of entity relationship mappings, and using that as a way of tracking what's going on in the dark web, you know, the things that don't appear within your normal web searches, all that good stuff. It's just kind of raw materials. What's interesting about that is, again, it's the thin end of the wedge argument. They sold it to us on the grounds that we can use it to track sex trafficking in America. Yes, you can use it to track sex trafficking in America. They absolutely underrepresent the fact that their funding is mainly DARPA funding, so the Defense Appropriations Research funding, and they're using it to track all kinds of political dissidents in America. So the good and the bad are absolutely necessarily cheek by jowl in this. When we're dealing with big data, we need to deal with due process. There is no set of rules. There is no set of regulations which is going to be the right set of rules and regulations. It's all about working out principles and practices of due process. Now, when we deal with big data, we often think about it in terms of everything is visible. We're living in an information plenum, a data plenum. Everything about us and our lives and about our planet is being connected. But there are massive areas of invisibility within the big data world. The older form of invisibility was you just couldn't get access to the data. It was hidden, you know, across filing cabinets all over the place, very much as the Ark of the Covenant was... the Holy Grail in the Indiana Jones movies was kind of buried in the Roosevelt, buried in the archives. Let's not do that again. Yeah, sorry, I'm speeding up ridiculously here. Big data is absolutely not complete. It is impossible in the United States to find out how many people are killed by police in a given year. It's getting slightly better right now. There's no central reporting mechanism. There are no databases. So the only project that I know about, actually, this is the Guardian newspaper in England. They're working together with a project in the States. This is called Accounted. When I did this a few months ago, it was this is this year's figures. It was just ticking over 500. I checked it just before this talk. It's now at 657 people have been killed by the police in the United States so far this year. We're headed for a record year, for what it's worth. But for all that we think we're collecting all data all the time, we really, really are not. We're really leaving huge gaps and data which becomes invisible and is rendered invisible. Particulate pollution in Pittsburgh, I'm talking about Olga Kuchenstier's work here, particulate pollution in Pittsburgh in Pennsylvania is, you can't find out details about it, because it's held by different agencies who will not speak with each other. There is no way to kind of really pull the data together. It's exactly the same, by the way, about the dangers of fracking. The reason that we don't get the dangers of fracking as well as we should do in America is because different agencies hold the data and will not talk with each other. And each one will have their own view of what's, their own partial view of fracking. So big data creates invisibilities. There are invisibilities in big data, as well as these enormous visibilities. And Olga Kuchenstier again did this fantastic study of Chernobyl. It's impossible to check who died in Chernobyl because they only collected one level of data about it, thyroid cancer, which is not the only form of death that occurred. According to the UN, only two people died because of Chernobyl. They also defined a child of Chernobyl as someone who was born within a certain radius, I think 12 kilometers, of the Chernobyl nuclear plant. That's inaccurate. But that was the only bins they were putting the data into. When we talk about data, we talk about big data as that which is given. Johanna Drucker has a wonderful phrase. She says, it's not data, it's capture. It's that which is taken. It's that which is captured. And when we think about what we are capturing as really the unit of analysis, that's another point that we really need to make major inputs into. Oh God, I'm talking far too much. All right, I'm going to do this one very quickly and then I'm going to skip to the conclusion. Indigenous knowledge and indigenous ways of knowing is one of my favorites there. The Indian Library of Indigenous Knowledge, for example, conjures data into a form so that the Indians can make intellectual property claims about their indigenous knowledge of medical practices, you know, kind of both yoga and herbs and spices and all that good stuff. So doing, they disaggregate the data from its spiritual meaning, its social meaning, its cultural meaning. They're capturing just that aspect of the data. No, I did that. I just love this title. I'll give you the title. Google announces plan to destroy all information it can't index. I mean, obviously, destruction. You know, we think of data in terms of, you know, in big data, again, in terms of, well, isn't it great that we're keeping everything, we have access to everything? It's a multi-billion dollar industry destroying data. And here's a wonderful program called Data Destroyer, talking about purging files. Actually goes way back, both in ancient classical Greece and in the English Civil War, there were acts of oblivion, thou shalt not talk about this. But we still have that going on today, thou shalt not talk about this. You're not going to get synchronization, I'm sorry. Actually, I showed a Looney cartoon as well. Actually not going to get that so much. All right, because I'm really skipping to the conclusion here. There are a couple of ways that you can think about what kind of humans we're creating right now within the world of big data. And Judith is going to talk a little bit about the 23andMe and the human genome. A human microbiome is really interesting. 90% of the cells in your body are not your genome, are not your genetic information. It's the flora and fauna that populate your body and which you are part of. Increasingly, the way in which we are human is in terms of ourselves and our data double. And it's completely analytically impossible to separate off that which is human and pure and exists and has a soul and exists inside the head. It's becoming increasingly impossible to separate that off from all of the data that circulates around us, that comes back in feedback loops, that predicts about us, that changes the way we see the world, changes the music that we'd like to listen to, changes the TV shows we watch and the books we read, and changes the representation that government has of you, so the way the government interacts with you, changes the way in which other people interact with you. It's you and the data double, which are together in this world. And the real morality that we need to work out, as we work out this new way of being human, the morality is not just how we protect ourselves from data. That's bullshit. There's no way. I mean, privacy really is gone. Data really is all around us. We are bathed in a sea of data. But it's how do we develop ethical and social and cultural practices around the data double and the importance of the data double and the centrality of the data double to our lives. Within design space, the way in which I like to put this is the design space is, it's a social space and a technical space, a local space and a global space. So, sorry, for those of you that know Leigh Star and Karen Rulida's definition of cyber infrastructure, this is the inner bit of this circle is the term she uses, that they use, sorry. But then recognizing that the design space is not only about designing technically, it's also about policy. It's also about social issues. And the decision that we need to make as designers is what falls out into legislation, what falls out into policy, and what is actually built into the machines. So the final slide. We're witnessing fundamentally new social forms. That's the Boulier argument, the vibrations I talked at a few times. I did not talk about synchronization, happy to do it in Q&A maybe. Humans and others, as we sync ourselves and the made world through the Internet of Things, we're using the same technology to sync the natural world. Big data is not about the world. It's always already theoretical. At which point, thank you. So open for discussion now as you want. I will And I realize I've rabbited on a little bit long. It's, what is it now? 2:47. Yeah, if we can just have about 15 minutes of discussion, or less if you choose, and then we'll turn it over to Judith for her leading a discussion on personal genome and quantified self. Yeah.
I was just wondering what impact did that have on epistemology at all?
And that's a marvelous question. The question is what impact big data has on epistemology and ontology. So it's really asking the big question. I mean, is it changing the ways in which we know the world? Well, absolutely. I mean, this is the kind of argument actually Ian Hacking makes in The Taming of Chance, where Ian Hacking says, drawing on A.C. Crombie, he says basically there were six ways of knowing the world, and then statistics came along. And statistics was a fundamentally new way of knowing the world than any of the previous ways. I mean, you know, Bayesian statistics with prediction, use of statistical analysis, and statistics invaded all scientific disciplines in the 19th century in much the same way as big data analytics is invading all scientific disciplines in the 20th century. So it changes it by developing a fundamentally new way of knowing. Ontologically speaking, which actually interests me more, this is the argument that gives me an opportunity to talk a little bit more about Dominique Boulier's argument. Dominique's argument, I don't know how many of you are sociologists, but it's basically Durkheim versus Tard. And so Durkheim was the sociologist who gave us statistics, you know, based on suicide rates and the equivalence of the amazing stability of suicide rates in different countries over Europe over time. That was the social fact. What Dominique talks about is that we are creating a new kind of social fact, and that new kind of social fact is the vibration. And it's much more based on mimesis, on contagion, you know, all these memes that we read about all the time, mimesis, you know, copying. So we are creating new ways of being socially. And those new ways of being socially, it's new social facts, it's new ways of existing, and it's a fundamentally new ontology. Yeah, this is the argument that what we're doing with big data is we're recovering that which was lost when we moved out of tribes, tribes and villages. Yeah, I mean, there's that marvelously prescient book by Marshall McLuhan, War and Peace in the Global Village. And that's precisely the argument that McLuhan makes, is that as we're creating these new media and moving into this heavily media-rich society, we're going back into a village away from being away from the anonymity that Baudelaire, when he talks about the flâneur in Paris. I mean, the whole thing is being invisible in the big city. And being invisible in this big city, totally silly reference, also Harry Harrison, the stainless steel rat. Yeah, that's impossible now. And that's theoretically impossible. And I think that's true. And I think we should look to tribal ways of being in order to deal with that. I mean, I lived in Cameroon for a couple of years, and living in a, especially being the only white guy in the village, I knew what it was like to live under total surveillance. But there are social practices you can develop around that. I mean, I've never known how much I believe, and I've never really read the analysis of it, but, you know, in Japan, for example, which is, one of those, very, surveilled societies, that thing that, you have to be absolutely obedient during the day, and at night you get drunk and you can slag off your boss, you can say whatever you want, and it will not come back to visit you the following day. That's the kind of practices that we need to relearn. And I think looking at tribal societies as a way of developing the right kinds of practices and processes in order to... I mean, Simon and Teresa were talking through very interestingly before about, living with uncertainty and uncertainty about the world. But living with that kind of moral ambiguity, that it shouldn't be a shock to you that we find out that someone, you know, engages in, you know, awful sexual practices or whatever, whatever. And that doesn't mean they can't be good politicians. The French are much better at dealing with that than the Americans. Yes, finding, recognizing that fundamental fact that we're living in a village again, I think is a marvelous thing for us to be doing. And it's one of those things where, again, lots of policy around big data is about, well, let's create these walled gardens. Let's try and shear up the wall, you know, the castle of the home. I'm sorry, you're just reminding me of something. George Bush once said there is no word for entrepreneurship in France, which I absolutely loved. It's typical.
Actually said, what do they know about business? They have no word for entrepreneur.
There we go. But you know, there is no word for there really is no word for privacy in France, and privacy, you know, was very much a mid to late 19th century invention within the English context. You know, a person's home is their castle. So moving beyond that as a social practice, and moving into a world where we accept that and deal with it in the right way, and this is exactly the levels of granularity argument that Teresa and Simon and I were talking about before, and Judith. That's where that comes into play. Yes, Simon.
Jeff, you said it's all going to be about due process rather than trying to come up with any overarching principle. Can you just unpack what do you have in mind when you talk about getting the right kinds of due process?
Yeah. All right, let me give two answers to that. The first is going to be from slightly away from your question, and the second is going to be a more direct answer. It's all a question of what ethics are, values and ethics. That one of the problems with ethics, as Jake Metcalf talks about, is seeing ethics as a series of nouns. You know, thou shalt be good, blah, 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 you know, around nouns that we need to configure ourselves around. Values is a much better language for that. Values are about verbs. Values are about doing in the world and being in the world. So it's not a question of developing a set of rigorous procedures built around nouns about the way in which things need to work. It's a question of creating values, ways of being, and discussing ways of being and discussing how we are with respect to data and our data use and big data. And also producing principles of due process. So it's not only educating ourselves and others around it, but recognizing, okay, if we are going, you know, Facebook is going to be taking your data. Yes, they are. Are they going to be using your data? Yes, they are. Will they be using it for unexpected reasons? Yes, they will. I mean, that's the whole point. We never know. I mean, that's one of the glorious things about big data. We never know how it's going to be used tomorrow. We're developing new algorithms all the time, and it's all about the algorithms, despite deep dive. We're developing new algorithms all the time. We've got all these possibilities all the time. So the question is, how do we create the principles and processes that means when a new configuration, when a new use comes into being, we can react very quickly to it? We did a study a few months ago of the ethical guidelines around data of, what is it, Computer Professionals for Social Responsibility, last updated 1973. American Library Association, last updated, I think, about 50 years ago. And these were the absolute regulations. Any code of practice that we found had no, code of ethics, had no update procedure. You know, it's just like, we have decided this is what works for our society. We're in a constant update mode right now, and it's exciting that we're in a constant update mode, but the constant update mode means that it's not about the Ten Commandments written in stone. It's about, okay, this is a new moral situation. It's a fundamentally new moral and social situation. That's what we're being confronted with on a daily basis. So the question for us is, how do we put in play the right kinds of procedures so when fundamentally new questions arise, we address them in a sufficiently fast fashion, sufficiently judicious fashion, and a sufficiently fair fashion. Got 4 more minutes, got another take one more question or pass over to Judith. Yeah.
I've noticed, because I'm very careful with Facebook, that Facebook doesn't know me yet.
Yeah.
So it'll serve up to me completely inappropriate ads. Well, that means I'm doing the right thing. But it also means that I'm not getting the best out of Facebook. What if I did want to know that particular thing, or where to buy a particular sock? Am I doing myself out of the benefits of this if I try and remain invisible?
Yeah, it's a great question. I mean, yeah. Your relationship with Facebook is a little bit like mine. I mean, I tend to friend anybody who friends me, but then I do nothing on Facebook myself, so I've got no idea what Facebook's representation of me is. Yeah, the question is, this is for the mic, the question is, if I remain deliberately remain invisible on Facebook, am I doing myself out of various possibilities? I think the answer has to be yes. I mean, it's a question of trade-offs. I mean, yes, you are. There are things that Facebook, you know, all those recommender systems will do great things for you. And they are getting better and better. I mean, one of the things I loved, my student Nick Seaver just did a fantastic thesis about music recommender systems. And music recommendation used to be based on social classification. They fit you into, you know, the marketing categories, you know, white, male. I call myself old, although I think we call ourselves the new middle age, and so on and so forth, and then kind of working out what the preferences were for that, for your particular social group, and then pushing that at you. The way they're working right now, all the recommender systems, is in terms of snatches of music, and a snatch of music which sounds like that snatch of music. So in a sense, they've gotten away from that really deleterious classification. I'm a guy, so I should like heavy metal and I shouldn't like the Andrews Sisters, and personally I love the Andrews Sisters. So they're moving away from that kind of classification system, but they're creating totally new ways, they introduce you to totally new kinds of music that you couldn't have imagined in the past. I don't know how many of you play with Pandora. That for me is one of the absolutely marvelous things about Pandora, things I didn't know I would like, but they're very good at telling me I would like it. So that's the upside of it. I mean, the downside is grooving it. I have particular penchants for different kinds of science fiction, for example. Amazon is just pushing me into a world where that's the only kind of science fiction I ever need to read. It will never be serendipitous with me. It will never say, you know, well, did you think of something complete? Let's try something completely different. The upside is done intelligently and done well. I think it does open you out to new universes. As it often works out in practice, it constrains your social space in ways that you don't even realize you're being constrained, because you think you've got everything you need and you're always discovering new and interesting stuff. Okay, I'm going to stop here and then I'm going to turn the floor over to Judith, who's going to talk about 10 or 15 minutes on personal genomics and big data.